meeting yesterday with the building department, and all systems are go. And so hopefully and prayerfully, it looks like it might be possible to be open by the 1st of July there at Twin Peaks. So right now, we're needing framers. So if any of you fellows are framers, would like work for about the next month or so, we'd be glad to hire you up there and need to get this job done. So if you're listening on the radio, if you're here tonight and you're a framer and you're needing work, contact us here and we'll put you to work. Let's turn now in our Bibles to the 13th chapter of Acts. The book of Acts takes sort of a new turn here at chapter 13. In Acts chapter 1:8, Jesus said, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you to be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, all Judea, Samaria, to the uttermost parts of the earth." So up till now, we have seen the witness of the church in Jerusalem, in Judea. We're going to move, and I guess we did move to Samaria, but tonight we're going to move, or the beginning of the movement, to the other parts of the earth. The remaining chapters of the book of Acts, about half of the book of Acts, will be devoted to the expansion of the church to the Gentiles. Up until now, it's been pretty much the Jewish church there in Jerusalem, but now we're going to start moving out to the Gentile church, and the remainder of the book will be concentrating about the work of the Spirit among the Gentiles as we move on out into all of the world. So the 13th chapter tells us that there were in the church that was at Antioch certain prophets and teachers. And it gives us then the names: Barnabas, Simeon, that was called Niger, and Lucius of Cyrene, and Manang, which had been brought up with Herod, the Tetrarch, and Saul. So we find that we have in these men an interesting cross-section. And of course, the church is made up of an interesting cross-section of people. The wide variety of men that have been unified in Christ Jesus. Barnabas, he was a Jew from Cyprus. Lucius came from Cyrene, which is in North Africa. Simeon was also called Niger, which is a Roman name. And because it was a given name, it means that he probably moved in Roman circles. Manane was a man with an aristocratic connections because he had been brought up with Herod. And finally, Paul, a former Pharisee, born in Tarsus, schooled in Jerusalem. And so we see how Jesus unifies such a wide spectrum of people. And you can see it here tonight, the wide spectrum, but one in Christ Jesus. And I love the way that the gospel brings us all together on a common level in Christ Jesus. And there's where we all stand. Now, there was in the church certain prophets and teachers. In Ephesians, the 4th chapter, we read that God has set in the church 4 different types of ministries: the apostles, the prophets, the evangelist, and the pastor teachers. And the purpose of these men are the perfecting of the saints for the work of the ministry, the building up of the body of Christ, to establish us in the unity of the faith to bring us into the knowledge of Jesus Christ, and to bring the church into a fully matured state, that we no longer be as babes who are tossed to and fro with every wind of doctrine and slight cunning of men, and then that we might be conformed into the image of Jesus Christ. Now, this is the purpose of the ministry gifts or gifted men within the church. The church's existence is, first of all, for the Lord. In a next verse, we will find that they were ministering unto the Lord, and we'll talk about what that means. And that's the first purpose of the church, is unto the Lord. We exist for Him. We are His church. We exist for Him. But then, secondarily, the church exists for the church. It is a place that we come to be built up in Christ. It's a place where we come to grow and to mature spiritually. And the church, I think, has oftentimes sort of misdirected the real purpose of the church. I've heard over and over the primary purpose of the church is the evangelization of the world. But I believe that the church exists for the church, and that a healthy church will be an evangelistic church. But that's the byproduct of a healthy church. It isn't the goal that we set for the church. That happens. The goal is the perfecting of the saints for the work of the ministry. The goal of the church is to bring the church into a full maturity in conforming us into the image of Jesus Christ. When Paul was writing to the Corinthians, he said, "For God has set some in the church, first the apostles, and then secondarily the prophets, and thirdly the teachers, and after that the miracles and the gifts of healings, the helps, the governments, and the diversities of tongues." Interesting how people can sort of many times get these things sort of reversed, and we put the main emphasis upon the more spectacular manifestations of the Spirit rather than the teaching of the Word of God. But you see, the miracles come after the teaching. And then he asks the question, are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Are all workers of miracles? Have all the gifts of healing? Or do all speak in tongues and do all interpret? So we do read that they had the gifts, or the gifted men who were prophets and who were teachers there in the church of Antioch. Now, in the church, the early church, the prophets, those that had the gift of prophecy, it was not so much a foretelling. The Old Testament prophets spent much of their ministry in foretelling the future, telling the judgments of God that were going to come upon the various nations, the form that the judgments would take, but mainly speaking and foretelling of Jesus Christ, of the Messiah and His coming. And so they were foretelling the future. Whereas in the New Testament prophets, they were more, what you would say, forth-telling. They were speaking forth God's word to the people. And because they were speaking under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, it could go over into the realm of telling the future. We've already read concerning Agabus, a prophet in the church in Jerusalem, who did prophesy of the great drought that would take place during the time that Claudius was the emperor of Rome. We will meet Agabus again towards the end of the book of Acts, still exercising his gift as a prophet, as he comes to Caesarea, and he takes Paul's girdle, binds himself with it, and he declares, so the man who owns this girdle will be bound when he comes to Jerusalem. So it was foretelling, but that in the New Testament is not mainly the office of the prophet. It was speaking forth the word of God. Paul said to the Corinthians, but he that prophesieth speaketh unto men, to edification, to exhortation, and to comfort. And so it is speaking to the church, to edify the church, to exhort the church, to comfort the church. Writing to Timothy, Paul said, don't neglect the gift that is in you, that was given to you by the prophecy and the laying on of the hands of the presbytery or the elders. So Timothy had the elders lay hands on him. There was prophecy. God had given Timothy a gift, and it was denoted by the prophecy. But Timothy had a penchant towards neglecting that gift. And so Paul had to tell him, stir up the gift that is in you. And again, don't neglect that gift that was given to you by prophecy and the laying on of hands of the elders. So we read then in verse 2 that they were ministering to the Lord and fasted. We think of ministry as something to the people, and we don't think very much what it means to minister to the Lord. The word minister does mean servant. And I am first of all a servant to Jesus Christ, and my first duties are to him. But because I am a servant of Jesus Christ, he has consigned me to be a servant to the church. So I am, first of all, a servant of Jesus Christ, but because he has commanded me, as my duty in serving him is to serve his church, thus I become a minister to the church or a servant to the church, but primarily it is serving Jesus Christ. And so by serving you, I'm actually serving him. We serve the Lord corporately in praise, in worship, and we were exercising that tonight as we were singing our praises and our minds were lifted in worship as we were declaring his work among us and his love and extolling him for what he is. And it's just ministering to the Lord is just oftentimes spending time, quality time with him. Oh, the pure delight of a single hour that before thy throne I spend. As I kneel in prayer and with thee, my God, I commune as friend with friend. There are many people who don't know the pure delight of spending a single hour with the Lord just in communion. But that's what it is to minister to the Lord. They were there, they were praying, they were praising, they were extolling the Lord, these men in the church of Antioch. I must wait upon the Lord in order to serve you. I must first experience that work of God in my heart, that I might in turn then impart the work of God that is done in my heart to your hearts. Paul the Apostle said, that which I have received from the Lord, I also delivered unto you. I wait upon the Lord that he might speak to my heart. And then I stand here and I share with you that which the Lord has spoken in my own heart. But I was, you see, first of all, ministering to him and waiting on him in order that I might receive from him, in order that I might deliver to you that which I have received. The husbandman, the scripture said, must first be partaker of the fruit. Sort of like the measles, you can't give them unless you got them. And you've got to have that work of God within your heart if you are going to be able to minister unto others. They were serving the Lord, it said, and fasting. One time the Pharisees came to Jesus and they said, how is it that the disciples of John and the Pharisees, we fast often, but your disciples don't fast? And Jesus answered, can the children of the bride chamber fast while the bridegroom is with them? As long as they have the bridegroom, they cannot fast. But the days will come when the bridegroom shall be taken away from them, and then shall they fast in those days. Fasting is something that you rarely hear about anymore. But the bridegroom has been taken away. And so we find them now ministering to the Lord and fasting. Paul the Apostle, speaking of his own experience, said that he was in fastings oft. What is fasting? Well, it is giving up something that feeds the flesh and replacing it with that which feeds the spirit. So it can be a fasting of food. It can be a fasting of entertainment or TV, anything that feeds the flesh. And partaking in those things which would feed the spirit, prayer, meditation, or feeding on the Word of God. In a sense, tonight, you are fasting. You could be home watching some stupid TV show. And be wasting this time. And how much time is wasted before the TV? And you could be engrossed in some movie or something like that and be entertained, and the flesh could be entertained, feeding the flesh. But you have chosen rather to come to hear the Word of God, because God's Word feeds the Spirit. And so, in a sense, tonight, you're engaged in fasting, denying the flesh in order to feed the Spirit. There are different types of fast. You can fast in a partial diet. Daniel went for a period of time, he fasted, but it was a partial fast. He did not eat pastries. He did not eat meat. And he went for a period of time denying pastries and meat. Now, it could be that you're sort of a chocolate-holic and you find yourself constantly feeding the senses by dark chocolate. You could say for a day or a week or a month, say, well, I'm just going to give up that particular delight of my flesh for the sake of the Lord and just as a sacrifice to Him. Those are called, as a rule, Daniel fast. There is a fast which is a total abstinence of food for a meal, for a day, or for a season, where you give up eating entirely. Say that you want to spend a day in fasting and prayer. And so for that day, you give up, or even just a meal. Say you want to really spend time with the Lord. You have an hour for lunch. You usually spend that hour going to a restaurant or something, sitting down and eating. But you decide that you want to just fast that meal and spend that time in prayer and in the Word, just opening your heart and seeking the Lord. So it's something that I think a person more or less determines in their own heart and mind of just how long they want to fast or what they want to fast. But it is that denying of the flesh, basically, and the denying of the feeding of the flesh in order to feed the Spirit. Now, our normal pattern of life is 3 regular meals a day. And that's our normal pattern of life. And if we don't get those 3 meals in, then, you know, you know, it's interesting, sometimes when I'm out with my grandkids, I usually don't eat lunch, and that's not a fast. I just don't do it. I mean, I just usually don't have time, and so I don't bother with lunch. It's not a spiritual thing, so don't think, oh, the pastor fasts every day from religion. No, it's just that I don't do it. And sometimes when I'm with the grandkids, you know, and I'll forget about lunch, and it'll be 4 o'clock in the afternoon. I say, well, where are you going to go for dinner? They say, we can't go for dinner. We haven't had lunch yet, you know. And you've got to get the 3 meals in, you know, or it isn't a day. But we are very regular. We make sure that we feed the flesh. But in the same token, so often we are starving the Spirit. You can go a week without the Word of God. You can go a week without, you know, taking some time in prayer or waiting on the Lord and all, and it doesn't seem to, you know, disturb you like if you had to miss an evening meal. So we are very regular on feeding the flesh, but quite often spasmodic as far as feeding the Spirit. No wonder when we have these battles, the flesh against the Spirit, we find the flesh often overcoming the Spirit, because the Spirit is so weak, it's been starved, and the flesh is so strong and healthy, you've been pampering it so much. And so what it is doing, fasting is sort of a reversal of the normal pattern of life. And it is denying the flesh while feeding the Spirit. Now, I do not believe that fasting has its full effect unless you take that time that you would be spending eating or preparing the food or watching the television or reading the daily paper. Unless you take that time that you are denying yourself and spend it then with the Lord, waiting upon Him. So they were ministering to the Lord and fasting. They were taking that time of just giving themselves over to the Lord, worship, prayer, waiting upon God, opening themselves to the Spirit of God, seeking the power of God within their lives, seeking to be directed and guided by the Spirit of God. And in so doing, they were denying the flesh while the Spirit was being built up through the prayer and through the worship. Now, when you begin to reverse the order, you'll discover that you begin to have great spiritual victories in your life. The spirit becomes strong as the flesh becomes weaker. Fasting should always be combined with prayer, waiting upon God. Now, as they were fasting and ministering to the Lord, the Holy Spirit said, now, how do you suppose the Holy Spirit spoke to them? The Holy Spirit said, was there just a voice in the room? How did the Holy Spirit speak to them? I think that the fact that they pointed up that there were prophets in the church in Antioch, that the Holy Spirit spoke to them through the gift of prophecy. Because he that prophesieth speaketh for edification, for exhortation and comfort. And I believe that it was through the gift of prophecy that they were directed to separate Saul and Barnabas for the ministry to which the Lord was calling them. I do think that today there could be a real problem in seeking guidance by this method. There are oftentimes people who come and say, the Lord told me to tell you. I get letters like this every week. The Lord telling someone to tell me. And oftentimes, it doesn't bear witness at all in my heart. Sometimes it does. But oftentimes it doesn't. But I would never go off on a venture on the basis of someone laid hands on me and prophesied that I should do a certain thing unless we have been in prayer together, fasting together, waiting upon the Lord for a specific purpose of just being directed by the Lord. There have been people who have gotten into serious difficulties because some evangelist passing through town prophesied over them that God was calling them to the mission field in Mexico. They were to sell everything and to move south. And following just that prophecy, found themselves out of place, defeated, discouraged, and oftentimes broke and just devastated spiritually because the prophecies were not fulfilled and they had gone just on the basis of somebody passing through and making that kind of a prophecy. We should seek for verification or confirmation through some other source than just the word of prophecy. Paul said in the church, when one prophesies, the others should judge. In other words, just don't go off on the basis that it was prophesied, but judge the prophecy. Is it really from the Lord? It's a very serious matter for a person to say, thus saith the Lord. Many times people couch their statement with, thus saith the Lord. I am very careful not to use that phrase unless I'm quoting Scripture. And when I'm quoting Scripture, I feel free to say, thus saith the Lord, and I'll quote Scripture. But just to use that as a phrase, to give emphasis upon what I'm saying. In the Old Testament, there was a problem. They had a phrase that was similar to that. It was the burden of the Lord. And people would go around saying, oh, the burden of the Lord. And this is the Lord's burden. And so he's going to pour out what God's burden is. The burden of the Lord. And God said to Jeremiah, Jeremiah, I'm sick and tired of hearing the phrase, the burden of the Lord. People going around and saying, the burden of the Lord, the burden of the Lord. He said, when I didn't put any burden on them. So he said, Jeremiah, I don't want you to use that phrase anymore. I'm so sick of it. If you use that phrase, I'm not going to talk to you. And so the Lord sort of put the silencer on that particular term because people were using it when God hadn't spoken or God hadn't laid any burden on them, and yet they were using that phrase. Peter warned the church concerning the false teachers that would rise within the church. He says that there were false prophets, actually, in the Old Testament, among the people, even as there shall be false teachers, he said, among you, who privately will bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. And many shall follow their pernicious ways, by reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken of. And through covetousness shall they with feigned words, flattering words, feigned words, make merchandise of you, whose judgment now of a long time lingereth not, and their damnation slumbereth not. Peter is saying that one of the ways by which you can discern a false teacher or a false prophet is the emphasis that they put upon money. Their desire is to make merchandise of you. And they will use gimmicks. They will use feigned words, false words. They will imply that by your giving, that you can actually have a lost loved one saved, and they'll tell stories of someone who sent in a sacrificial offering and their son or daughter came to Christ, you know, or they were healed of some malady and all, which is a horrible thing, suggesting that you can actually buy the favors of God. When Simon came to Peter desiring the power to lay hands on people that they might receive the Holy Spirit, how much will it cost me? Peter said, your money perish with you. And he rebuked him, told him to repent and pray that maybe God would forgive him, because he thought that the powers of God could be bought, or the favors of God could be bought with money. And any kind of implication that you can buy the work of God by contributing to some ministry is absolutely false, unscriptural, and it immediately marks that person as a false prophet in the scriptures. The desire to make merchandise of the people, the heavy emphasis on money. Interesting that in the early church, there were these bands of prophets that would go around. They were sort of gypsy-like roving bands of men who went around professing to have the gift of prophecy. And so many of the churches were new. They weren't really well-founded yet in the Word. And there was a lot of excitement. There was a lot of emotion in the early church because of the newness and the excitement of discovering Jesus Christ and the forgiveness of sins and the hope of eternal life in Him. And people were excited. And so these men would go around and they would take advantage of that. They would come in and they would profess to be prophets. And they would, you know, get into their spiritual kind of shakings and jerks, you know, and prepare a meal, steak, rare, you know. Thus saith the Lord, you know. And so the apostles felt it necessary to sort of send a warning to the churches and sort of guidelines by which they could tell a true prophet from the false prophet. And in this guidelines, it's called the Didache, in the guidelines that they sent, one of the things was, if a prophet comes and orders a meal to be prepared by the church for the poor, if he eats of it, he's a false prophet. And if he spends more than one day without working, he's a false prophet. And so those that would try and live off of others and using feigned words to make merchandise, they were branded in the early church as false prophets. So it's important that we become like the church in Berea, who, when they heard the teaching of Paul, they went home and they searched the scriptures to see if those things were so. So it is important that we not be deceived, that we measure everything by the word of God. And if a word is spoken supposedly through the anointing of the Holy Spirit, if it is not in keeping, if it is not in line with the written word, then we are to reject it. And the same with experiences. We need, again, to search the scriptures. And if the experience doesn't line up with the written word, then we are to reject it. It's important that we have guidelines. And the Bible is the guideline for the Christian walk and the Christian experience. And it is the final authority for our faith and practice. The experience cannot be the final authority. The Word of God has to be the final authority for our faith and practice. Personally, I'm not interested in any kind of a manifestation for which there is not a solid scriptural basis. I mean a solid scriptural basis. I don't want you to just tell me, well, the soldiers fell over in the garden. That's not what I see happening on TV today. And there's no relationship between the soldiers falling over in the garden and people falling over because someone waves a jacket at them. You've got to have a solid scriptural basis for the experiences. The Bereans, search the scriptures. Find out if there's a biblical basis for the experience. And you don't measure the scriptures by the experience. You measure the experience by the scriptures. The Bible is our authority for our faith and our practice. Now, I say that, but yet I will add, there are a lot of experiences in the Bible that I'd love to have, that I haven't yet had. And I would be open and would love to have some of the experiences that I read about in the Bible. There's enough in the Bible that I don't have, that I don't have to go beyond the Bible to find something that is unique or whatever. I really don't want some new kind of a novel experience of some new revelation. I want a new experience in the old revelation, the Bible that is there. I want a fresh experience with God and a fresh experience daily with Him. And so here we are in the church of Antioch. We have prophets and teachers there. and a good cross-section of people. These men are serious in their commitment to the Lord. They are ministering to the Lord, and they are fasting. And in this environment, the Holy Spirit speaks to them, and as I said, I believe through the gift of prophecy, as he separates Paul and Barnabas for the first missionary team to take the gospel now beyond the borders on out into the uttermost parts of the earth where Jesus commanded the disciples to go with the gospel. I see here a church that is led and directed by the Holy Spirit, which I believe is the secret to the success of that early church. You know, you can go today to seminars all over the country in which you can learn methods by which to increase the attendance, building a mega church or large churches. And these seminars are being offered. If you get Christian magazines, you'll usually find two or three of them advertised in the Christian magazines where you can go and pay $175 and learn how to grow your church. All of the methods, how to canvass the community, how to make a demographic study, how to determine the greatest needs. What kind of a community are you in? Is it a family community? Then you need to develop this kind of a program. Develop a program for the community and all of this. And I have yet to see a seminar in which they say, come, no cost. We're going to just minister to the Lord and fast and wait upon the Lord for the power and the guiding of the Holy Spirit to show us how he wants his church to reach the community. That's what they did. And they just didn't reach their community, they reached the world. And they were successful in doing it. The church is losing ground as far as world evangelism is concerned. The government of France is now considering, in fact, there are bills before the government in France which will actually prohibit people from trying to entice others to their way of belief. That's in France. Only about 1% of the people in France go to church. Now, at one time, the church was a powerful movement in France. But today, it is almost dead, and the government is trying to kill what remains with new laws. And they are defining now so many as cults. And they are creating laws that are just, they're attempting to just quiet the voice of the church completely in France. Tomorrow on the To Every Man an Answer radio broadcast, we'll have a pastor from France with us. We're going to interview him. He has been a pastor over there for some 20 years. He was a hippie on the East Coast, and much like the many hippies that were here, accepted the Lord, felt called of God, went over to France as a hippie going out, and he's been there for 20 years and ministering, and God has blessed him. He has a Bible school, and they're sending out. But the government now has branded him a cult and are threatening to close him down. And he'll be sharing what's going on. But that's throughout Europe. And doors are closing. Now, in the early church, without all of the modern means that we have today, they reached their world in their lifetime with the gospel. Paul, when he wrote to the Colossians, some 30 years after he was converted, writing to the Colossians, he said, "And the word of the gospel as it has come to you, as it is in all the world." They could declare, after 30 years, they had touched the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now here we are so many years later, and the percentage of the world that knows the gospel today is far less than knew it then. And we've got radio, we've got TV, we've got all types of means of communication, we've got printing, we've got, you know, all of these things, and yet we seem to be relying and trusting in the arm of flesh rather than in the Holy Spirit. The secret of the early church was it was directed by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit said, "Separate unto me Saul and Barnabas." Guided, directed by the Holy Spirit, and directed by the Holy Spirit, they could reach the world. We need to take a lesson, and we need to minister to the Lord, fast, wait upon God, and be directed by the Spirit, that we might be effective, more effective, in reaching our community, reaching our Judeas, reaching our Samarias, and reaching the uttermost parts of the earth. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. God said he doesn't change. He is able, but it takes a commitment on the part of the people. We've got to deny ourselves. We've got to take up the cross and follow him. And we can see the same success today that they experienced in touching their world for Jesus Christ. Father, we pray that you'll speak to our hearts and challenge us, Lord, this day. And Lord, may we be willing to deny ourselves, to take up the cross, and to follow you. May we spend more time, Lord, ministering to you and fasting, denying the flesh, and building up the Spirit, setting aside the things that pander to the flesh, and engaging, Lord, in those things that will feed the Spirit. Lord, we realize that time is short. There are thousands of people tonight who are dying and going to a Christless grave. Somehow, some way, Lord, help us that we might reach them with the good news of God's love and God's provision for their salvation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Shall we stand? The pastors are down here tonight to pray with you. If you desire to make a real commitment today, tonight, God's been speaking to your heart, you've been challenged, and you'd just like to make that commitment to the Lord with someone else, they're here to pray for you that you might indeed make that determination. I'm going to follow Jesus. I'm going to do his will. I'm going to serve him and be effective as I wait upon the Spirit, ministering to the Lord, allowing God to have my life and to use my life. So as soon as we're dismissed, come on down. They'll be here to pray with you. This could be the start of something exciting in your life. Who knows where it might lead? I will serve you because I love you. You have given life to me. I was nothing until you found me. You have given life to me. Heartaches, broken people, ruined lives are why you died on Calvary. Your touch is what I long for. You have given life to me. You have given life to me.
And now, on behalf of the Word for Today, the broadcast ministry of Pastor Chuck Smith, we thank you for joining us in today's broadcast. For more of Pastor Chuck's studies and biblical teaching resources, visit our website at pastorchuck.org. You can contact The Word for Today at The Word for Today, P.O. Box 890-820, Temecula, California, 92589. Or email us at infopastorchuck@gmail.com. We'll return with more of our verse-by-verse Bible study in our next broadcast with Pastor Chuck.